So the verb beware in English only has the base form. So you can say, you must beware of the dog, base form complement of the modal, or the base form used in the imperative, beware of the dog. But there's no past tense. You don't say, I bewared the dog. And you also don't have the present tense form that happens to be phonologically the same as the base form. So you don't get they beware the dog, with or without the of. Right? So these are idiosyncrasies, weirdly robust that English speakers know this. How do we learn it? And we want one model of English that captures all of this in one consistent context. So one slide key idea. So how do we do this? Well, we do it with a rich, precise formalism where we can have features to talk about specific things. We do it by allowing ourselves to have both very general phrase structure rules, like the head complement rule, and also very specific ones that are used for particular constructions. We do it by allowing ourselves features to block certain lexical entries from going through particular lexical rules. So keeping beware out of everything but the base form one's pretty easy. You just say its form value is base, and that makes it incompatible. Keeping certain verbs out of the passive lexical rule might require a special purpose feature, but we can do that in our formalism. Okay, we have hit all of the key ideas. So it's a monostratal theory of grammar. One structure per analysis per string. Everything is assigned, pairing with form and meaning. We use typed feature structures that we combine via unification, and we put a lot of information in the lexicon while respecting the lexical integrity hypothesis, and that allows us to capture generalizations at different granularities. I think I got it all in one sentence. We did 90 minutes. End of the presentation, but it's not.
We're applying the first act. Uncultured people will applaud each segment of a musical piece.
Right.
It's still possible not to applaud at all, right?
Or throw flowers or something. Right.
So I'm going to tell you a little about theoretical commitments and extensions, and I think I'm going to skip the grammar matrix stuff, except like really fast, high level. Okay. So the theoretical commitments of this framework. One is formal precision. We want to make sure that our analyses are encoded precisely enough that we can calculate what the predictions are and then compare them to what we see in the data, rather than thinking about what they should be and comparing that to what we see in the data. Because it's too easy to assume that what they should be is what's in the data. You have to be able to actually mechanically work it out. It also allows us to implement it and test it in grammar engineering, which will be the second half. That sort of correlates with the second idea of dissociating theory and formalism. So the formalism is very general. In fact, it's Turing complete. It's very, very powerful. We have lists. Those could be tapes. You can have as many as you want. You've got a Turing machine. But that means that we can have this formalism that is general enough that we can state different theories in it. The formalism is well worked out mathematically. It's implemented actually multiple times over so that we can test it on computers. And then that's stable, and we can use it to test out different theories. We take a relatively bottom-up approach to language universals. So the idea is we would like to describe many different languages and ask ourselves, are these the same? What's the same? What generalizations do we find? With the asterisk that we are formal linguists, so we approach a language typically with expectations. And so it's not purely bottom-up. We're only going to see what the data tell us and then try to go from there all the way to cross-linguistic terms. I think typologists might take issue with me claiming bottom-up here. There's a commitment to the notion of performance-plausible competence grammar. So I said at the beginning that we share the idea of a competence-performance distinction. But furthermore, we have the idea that our competence model ought to be directly compatible with someone's performance model, and not some abstract thing that can't be plugged into a model of performance for parsing generation, grammaticality judgments, crossword puzzles, etc. Similarly, it should be process independent. So we've got one model of linguistic knowledge that is used in all of those different performance tasks. And then finally, there's the idea of, and shared with SVCG, of a uniform representation of many levels. So our signs include not just syntax and semantics, but they include morphological information, if you're doing a better job than I was at the morphology, and they can include pragmatic information, and they can include constraints that cross those levels. So you can have a form that says, you know, this is a second person formal pronoun. So it's putting information in about the semantics, about the syntax, and about the pragmatics all in one sign. And this is, as I was saying, shared with SBCG. Okay, a couple of quick extensions. The first one is, I think there's going to be at least one talk that uses linearization theory in the conference, so I wanted to put in a slide on this. The notion that you could separate what's called technogrammatical structure and phenogrammatical structure. And I also wanted to put the slide in because those words are fun to say. So the technogrammatical structure is a sense of the order, and I've got scare quotes there, the order in which constituents are combined with each other. And the idea there is that things are more, the constituent structure has to do with what's more closely combined than what else in the tree, right? So it's order not in a procedural sense, but order in that how tightly they're bound sense. But the phenogrammatical structure is what you actually observe in the surface stream. And so there's this idea, which I think is due to Reed 94, that you can say, well, we're going to treat that phonological or orthographic form as a feature rather than the leaves in the tree. And then we're going to say, we put constituents together, and just like we calculate the semantic information on the mother as a function of what's on the daughters, we're going to calculate the phonological or orthographic information on the mother as a function of what's on the daughters. But that function could be something other than a simple append. And so we have this notion of shuffle and ordering domains, and that's all very interesting. It's been applied in the analysis of the topological fields in Germanic languages, and also the radical free word order found in Australian languages, among others. And its roots actually go back earlier. So GPSG, which is one of HPSG's primary predecessors, had this notion of linear precedence being separate from immediate dominance in the phrase structure schemas. But linearization theory sort of takes that and runs with it. It complicates parsing algorithms. Right? If the surface order of the words is not just a simple append of how they are in the yield of the tree, then parsing is much more complicated. So it's not part of my everyday as a grammar engineer, but it is something out there at HPSG, so I wanted you to know about it. The other extension I want to talk about is constructions and sign-based construction grammar, and actually I've been talking about this throughout, right? So construction grammar introduced the notion of a constructicon, which is like the lexicon, that is this rich collection of things, but instead of it being lexical entries, it's also phrase structure rules and other kinds of constructions, some of which are very general, like the head complement rule, and some are very idiosyncratic. So one of the early papers was the What's X Doing Y paper by KFM199. This helps us handle both core and periphery in one grammar, because there are some constructions that you just can't get to with the seven original HPSG phrase structure rules, though apparently not as many as KM Fillmore maybe thought. Ivan Sog did a lot of work of saying, no, we can do that one with a lexical rule, or you know, add this lexical entry and it'll work. Constructions like lexical types are organized into a type hierarchy to capture generalizations across them. So for example, the analysis of coordination in the English Resource Grammar and the Grammar Matrix involves a large family of constructions for coordinating different types of constituents, but they share constraints. And so we have supertypes that have those constraints encoded, and then the specific constructions only have to state what's specifically idiosyncratic to them. So this construction grammar-y approach was actually in the Lingo project from early on, and those citations don't quite show how early on, because the Lingo project, I think, officially started in 1993, is that right? And has been formalized in sign-based construction grammar. And I think we're going to hear more about SBCG from Laura tomorrow morning. All right. And then the last extension that I'm really going to fly through here is the grammar matrix, just because it's my project and I'm going to steal a little bit of time to talk about it. So the idea of the grammar matrix is a grammar engineering project, and the idea behind it was to say we've learned a lot in working on the English Resource Grammar. And I say we because I contributed some, though Dan is the main author, about grammar engineering for English, but grammar engineering in general, and some of those constraints probably aren't specific to English. And so the grammar matrix is an attempt to abstract out what's plausibly shared across languages, and then pair it with a series of libraries that have been based on surveys of the typological literature to handle constructions that vary across linguistically. And so it's a web page that's down right now because we are suffering through a denial of service attack, which is really annoying, but hopefully we'll be up within a couple of weeks. And when it is up, you can go to our webpage and fill out this questionnaire describing your language. and out pops a customized grammar in the style of the EOG that matches the specifications that you gave us. So this is a screenshot of sort of the top level page of all the different things you can fill in. This is what it looks like if you're working on the morphology for nouns, and so on. And I'm happy to answer questions about this later, so if you want to know more, come talk to me. I teach a course at UW where I have students building grammars of languages based on descriptive resources and the grammar matrix over 10 weeks. And for fun, we wrap it up with an MT extravaganza. We put all of these languages, plus English and one other one from a previous year, together into an end-by-end machine translation system. I've been doing this since 2004, when I picked up the idea from Petter. Oh, it's Petter. I thought he was going to be here. There he is. So he was the first crazy person to do a class like this, and then I stole that idea. And since 2004, these are the languages we've worked on. I don't let the students repeat languages, with a couple of exceptions. So I'm typically not getting Indo-European anymore, but you would be amazed at how many Romance languages there are. And you can kind of see that on the map. All right, so this year, these are the ones that we did. And I have a student who makes cupcakes for me. this slide, and the slides are available online through the HPSG site, so you can look at this later. But this lists out the grammar coverage that ends up in these grammar fragments, and I would say about two-thirds of the phenomena listed here are things that you can do just via the customization system, and then the rest of it is hand editing of TDL, because in the class they're learning about how to actually do grammar engineering as well. We do a transfer-based machine translation system. I'm going to get into the details. There's these 24 sentences with a closed vocabulary, but they illustrate the phenomena on that previous slide. And here is just one result slide showing for the 10 languages, input to output, how many of the sentences went through of those 24. Do they come out as correct? Well, probably. Do we get noise? Yes, because there's always ambiguity, and so we get multiple parses, multiple transfer outputs, multiple generation outputs. But it is a lot of fun, and it shows the power of parsing into similar semantic representations so that we can build this translation system. And that is all I have to say about that. So we are now done with the first half.
Now we can clap.
One thing. The people that are with us now via live streaming ask me if they can see the audience. And I want to just move the laptop a little bit in order to have a picture of you all.
Sure. And then we should get to see them too, right?
That's true. And there's coffee outside and some snacks.
Yeah.
So,
Before you ask your question, just to let people know, I think we still want to allow 15 minutes. Your brain is going to get sore if you do this much longer without a break. So take 15 minutes, but not more than that. Come back in, and then we will still finish at 6 o'clock. I can reduce the amount of time I need for talking about the implementation. I could also talk for a week, so we'll just fit it into the time that we have. It's a quick question.
It's a quick one. I don't know whether the answer is quick. So, because this is a typological project, this one, right?
Yeah.
So, I'd just be very interested to know how you would place yourself with respect to the Haspelmath-Neumeier debate. So, one say, okay, there's only the comparative concepts, and they are more like conceptually, semantically defined, and there's Neumeier more from the generative Chomsky tradition, who says, oh no, wait, in order to do our comparative job, we need to bring individual grammars and typological questions together, and we need something like universal or comparable form categories.
Yes, so I definitely end up with Neumeier on that one, because I am reusing the same form categories. So what I'm providing via the grammar matrix customization system is form meaning pairings, so there's form as well. But I'm doing it, I'm a practical grammar engineer. And so I'm not saying this is necessarily the truth of these languages. I'm saying I think it'll be useful in modeling these languages. So, like
our categories are quite fine grained, so and we can combine syntax around it, so that might help as well.
Yeah.
Okay, now take a break.
Yes, take a break.
Check your watches, 15 minutes.